So starting with the today's lecture, first summary of previous lectures. In this, we are going to discuss the drug proving, that is from aphorism number 105 to 145. That is regarding the how to gain the knowledge of instruments that is adapted for the cure of natural disease. In this, what is given in 105, it is regarding the investigation of pathogenetic power of medicine, and in this they explain about the definition of drug, what is mean by drug, what is mean by proving, and what is mean by drug proving. Then this is the investigating the pathogenetic power of the medicines intended to the cure of natural disease. Then we studied aphorism number 106. It is regarding the knowledge of medicine, as the physician must have a thorough knowledge of medicine which he is going to use for the treatment of the patient. And in this we also know or prove the as many as medicines or the remedy that can cure the as many as the natural diseases. So this is given in aphorism number 106. Then as many drugs as possible must be proved, so that we could select the homeopathic remedies for almost all natural diseases. Then in 107, we studied that drug should not be proved on a sick person. So what is the reason that proving should not be done on a sick person is because the precise true effects of the drug cannot be noted as peculiar alterations of the health. To be expected from the medicines are mixed up with the symptoms of disease and can seldom be distinctly observed. So this is the effect, that is when we prove the medicine on sick person, the symptoms of the sick person and the symptoms of the remedy can get matched or can get mixed, and we cannot get the true picture of the medicines or the drug. So we cannot prove the medicines on a sick person. Then in 108, it is regarding the how the drug proving is done, or the drug proving must be done on a healthy person. That is how drug proving is done. In this, we have to administer the moderate doses to the prover. Then the prover must be a healthy person. Then to ascertain what changes, symptoms, signs of their influence, each individually produces on the health of the body and the mind. And the curative power of the medicine lie in this power they possesses of changing the state of man health, and is revealed by observations of the latter. So this is given in aphorism number 108. That is, the drug proving must be done on a healthy human beings. Then they given the footnote under aphorism number 108, which describes that is, it was only Ohnhaller besides the master who have done proving in healthy human beings for the past 25,000 years back. So Ohnhaller is the first person who put forth the idea of drug proving on healthy human being. Then in 109, Dr. Hahnemann took the credit of drug proving by himself. And in this, that is, it was the master who opened up this path of human proving. And it only by the homeopathic employment of medicines that the certain cure of human maladies is possible. So this is given in 109, and 109 having a footnote. In this, it having a 2 points. First one, that is the it given that the scope of homeopathy and the demerits of antipathy or the allopathy, and they also given the where the scripts of drug proving is collected, from where the script of drug proving is collected in footnote under 109. Then in 1010, we studied about the role of doctrine of signature or the effect of the drug in allopathy, that is recording of symptoms on healthy human beings in allopathy, that their intention is not to record the symptoms, but it is done by mistakes or by the suicide, when someone take the poisonous drug by mistake or by for the reason of suicide, and they collect the symptoms and they put for that they having the record of proving the drug on healthy human beings. Dr. Hahnemann was against this in 110, but in 111 he gives agreement to the observations of the allopath, that is recording of symptoms by mistakes or by taking for the suicidal tendency. In 111 we see that why this poisonous act therapeutically, that is like the pure effects of medicines, that is medicinal substance act in the morbid changes they produce in the healthy body according to fixed internal laws of nature, and by virtue of this are enabled to produce certain reliable disease symptom each according to its own peculiar character. Then in 112 we studied about the primary and secondary action on drug proving. In this, when we prove the drug in crude form or in dynamic form, when we prove the drug in crude form, it gives the primary and secondary action, that is it shows the pathological changes in that prover when we prove the medicine in crude form. But when we use the dynamic form of medicine, in that we get only the primary action of medicine and sometimes the secondary action. And when we prove the medicine in dynamic form, the vital force overcome it very easily. So this is the proving or the primary and secondary action of drug in drug proving, when we use the crude form of drug and in dynamic form of drug. In this they also explain, that is when, that is secondary action is the reverse of primary action, states which were of an exactly opposite nature to those that first appeared due to excessively large dose, that is the drug proving in large doses, moderate doses and smaller doses. When we prove the medicine in large dose, it gives primary and secondary action both, but when we prove in moderate doses, it gives only primary action and sometimes secondary action. But when we prove the medicine in small doses, it gives only a primary action and not secondary action at all in smaller doses. So this is regarding the primary and secondary action during drug proving. Then in 113 we studied that the proving of narcotic drugs, that is the exceptions to the above is the narcotic drugs, as narcotic drugs shows the secondary action even in the moderate doses, that is in their primary action take away the sensation, sensibility, and later an increased sensibility, irritability is observed. Then in 114 we studied about the, with the exception of narcotic medicines, we observe only the primary action with moderate doses of medicine on healthy bodies. Then in 115, the most important, we studied about the alternating actions of the drug. In alternating actions, the alternating action means one symptom alternates with the other symptoms, and these are the primary action only, but the physician can confuse with these symptom as a secondary action, that physician may feel the it is a secondary action, but actually this is not the secondary action, these are the alternating action of that drug. So in that we take example as constipation alternates with diarrhea, this is one of the characteristic symptom of abrotanum, and these alternating actions are very important as these are very peculiar in character and these are important for the selection of the similimum. So alternating action described in aphorism number 115, you have to remember that alternating actions, aphorism number 115. And what is mean by alternating action, that is one symptom alternates with the other symptoms and in the exact opposite way. Then the alternating actions seen only with some remedies, that is conditions directly opposite to the symptoms observed, these are not the secondary actions or the reactions of the vital force, but these represents alternating state of the various paroxysms of the primary action. Then In 116, we studied about the medicines or the drug must be proved on a number of people and not on a few individuals or a single individual. In this, why we prove the medicines on a number of people or on a group of people? For this, the symptoms are produced by the medicines more frequently, that is to say, in many individuals, others more rarely, or in few persons, some only in a few healthy bodies. That is, when we prove the medicine on a prover, on a single prover, or on a group of provers, as we have to prove the medicine on a number of peoples or a group of peoples and not on a single individuals or a few individuals. The reason is that some symptoms may be seen in all provers, some symptoms may be seen in 50% of provers, but some symptoms are there that can be seen only in 1 to 2 provers or only in a very few provers. And for this reason, we have to prove that drug on a number of individuals or a group of individuals and not on a single individuals. And for this, it explained about the idiosyncrasy. What I explained in previous lecture, that is idiosyncrasy. So what is mean by idiosyncrasy? That is, idio means self and syn means that is along with, and crasy means that is the constitution or the physical makeup of the person. And in this, Dr. Honeyman explained about the idiosyncrasy as it is a peculiar corporeal constitution which, although otherwise healthy, possesses a disposition to be brought into a more or a less morbid state by certain things which seem to produce no impression, no change in many other individuals. That is, it is a specific type of constitution, as this is present in few of the peoples. That is, some constitutions are specific, or these are oversensitive constitutions, that if these peoples are exposed to certain things, that produces the symptom in that persons, but these things cannot produce any impression or any change in many other individuals. So these are the specific constitutions or the oversensitive constitution which are sensitive to that certain things, that certain things disturbs their morbid state or may create in them a morbid state, that is produce in them the signs and symptoms by exposure to these things. That is the idiosyncrasy. So you have to remember this definition as what is mean by idiosyncrasy. Idiosyncrasy means it is a peculiar corporeal constitution which, although otherwise healthy, these are the healthy peoples, but possesses a disposition to be brought into more or less morbid state by certain things which seem to produce no impression, no change in many other individuals. So these peoples are called as a idiosyncratic people. For this, Dr. Honeyman also explained the footnote under aphorism number 117. And in this footnote, it is explained the examples of idiosyncrasy. That is, some peoples are, when exposed to the smell of roses, can get faint, or the sensation of fainting. So these peoples are oversensitive to the smell of rose, but the other peoples cannot get any symptom after the smell of rose. So these peoples who get faint from the smell of rose are idiosyncratic to the smell of rose, and we call them as a oversensitive patient or the idiosyncratic patient. So in this footnote, Dr. Honeyman gives some examples regarding the idiosyncrasy. And for this, he also explained that is, to know the effect of the medicine, we have to know the two things. And these two things are the inherent power of the influencing substance or the capability of the vital force that animates the organism to be influenced by it. So these are the two things that gives the effects of the medicines. So this is footnote, and in this, the two things for the productions of the idiosyncrasy are the inherent power of the influencing substance, and second one, that is capability of the vital force that animates the organism to be influenced by it. And these healthy constitution have a tendency to allow themselves to be brought into such an obvious morbid condition by them. So these are a good provers. As we know, the idiosyncratic peoples are oversensitive peoples, and when we prove the medicines on them, they give each and every symptom of that drug. And for this reason, these are very good provers, as they prove that drug in a very well manner and give the symptoms very nicely, as their constitution is oversensitive to that particular things. So this is the view of Dr. Hahnemann regarding the idiosyncrasy. I also explained the concept of Dr. J.T. Kent and concept of Dr. Stott Close regarding the idiosyncrasy. And in this, we studied that the concept of Dr. J.T. Kent, as he explained the idiosyncrasy as an oversensitive to one thing or a few things. As he explained idiosyncrasy as an oversensitiveness, and that oversensitiveness may be for one thing or a few things. And in this, he explained the examples as sensitiveness to the opium and the cinchona. Then he classified the idiosyncrasy into two types, that is acute idiosyncrasy from acute miasm and chronic idiosyncrasy from the chronic miasm. Then he also explained the different examples, that is smell of flowers, lavender flowers, etc. And he tells that if idiosyncrasy to a particular remedy is not present, the patient will not susceptible enough to be cured. The state in which he becomes sensitive enough to a drug to cure him is very analogous to this idiosyncrasy. And he again classified the idiosyncrasy into two types, that is acquired idiosyncrasy and the inborn idiosyncrasy. And he also gives the example of idiosyncrasy, or explained about the idiosyncrasy in 8th observation, in Kent's 12th observation. That is, 8th observation is that the patient prove every remedy they get. Such patients are said to be idiosyncratic patients, as prognosis after observing the action of the remedies. So this is the 8th observation out of 12th observation of Kent, Dr. Kent. So this is the view of Dr. Kent regarding the idiosyncrasy, as it is a oversensitiveness to one thing or the few things. Then what is the concept of Dr. Stott Close? In concept of Dr. Stott Close, he explained about idiosyncrasy as a habit or a quality of the organism peculiar to the individual. It is peculiarly of the constitution, inherited or acquired, which makes the individuals morbidly susceptible to some agents or influence which would not so affect others. So what Dr. Stott Close explained about idiosyncrasy, as idiosyncrasy, it is a habit or a quality, and it may be present in a peculiar individuals, and it is a peculiarity of that constitution that may be inherited or acquired. So he also classified the idiosyncrasy into two types, that is inherited idiosyncrasy and second one, that is acquired idiosyncrasy. So this is the concept of Dr. Stott Close regarding the idiosyncrasy. Then we studied the aphorism number 118. So what 118 explained, that is individuality of the drugs, that is every medicine exhibit peculiar actions on the human frames which are not produced in the exactly same manner by any other medicinal substance of a different kind. And he also explained the footnote, that is this fact was also pursued by the own Haller. Then in aphorism number 119, it is regarding the individualization of the drug action. And in this, since there is individuality in medicines, no surrogates in homeopathy. And in this, we know that each and every species of plant is different in its external form, mode of life, growth and taste, smell, and other species and genus of plants. all are different. Certainly, as every mineral salt differs from all other in its external as well as internal physical and chemical properties, and that's why they are having their own individualizing pathogenetic properties which differs from all other drug substances. As each and every substance in the world are different, as the two atoms of the same medicines are also different, so their action or their effect on the prover must be different, and for this reason we get the individuality of the medicines. That is, each medicine is different and it produces the different effect on the provers, and for this reason in footnote under 119 it is explained about there is no place to the surrogates in the homeopathy. That is, no equivalent remedies whatever, no surrogates. That is, surrogates means one can replace with the other, and only those who do not know the pure positive effects of the different remedies can be so foolish as to try the pursued as that one can serve in the stead of the other and can in the same disease prove just as a serviceable as the other. So in 119 they explain about there is no place for the surrogates in homeopathy. That is, we cannot use one medicine for the other medicine. If one medicine is not available to us, we cannot use the other remedy as a surrogates, as we know that each medicine having its different peculiar character, and that peculiar character can produce the different kind of symptom or different effects in that prover or in the patient. So there is no place for surrogates in homeopathy. You have to remember that sentence, there is no place for surrogates in homeopathy. So up till now we finished aphorism number 119. Now in today's lecture we are going to start with the aphorism number 120. So for this I will first read the aphorism, that is aphorism number 120. Therefore, medicines on which depend man's life and death, disease and health must be thoroughly and most carefully distinguished from one another, and for this purpose tested by careful pure experiments on the healthy body for the purpose of ascertaining their powers and real effects in order to obtain an accurate knowledge of them and to enable us to avoid any mistake in their employment in diseases, for it is only by correct selection of them that the greatest of all earthly blessings, the health of the body and of the mind, can be rapidly and permanently restored. So what is given in aphorism number 120, as it is regarding the importance of the careful proving of drugs. What is the importance of careful proving of drugs, or there must give the importance to the careful proving of drug? Why we give importance to the careful proving of the drugs? So in this they explain as the medicines on which depends man's life and death must be thoroughly and carefully distinguished from one another, tested by careful pure experiments on healthy body for ascertaining their powers and real effects in order to avoid any mistake in their employment in diseases, so that health of the body and mind can be rapidly and permanently restored. So we know that medicines are those on which man's life and death is depend. Our life is also depend on a medicines, and death is depend on a medicines. If we go in a correct way, there is a life, and if we go in a wrong way, there is a death. So while proving that medicines which are so important must be carefully proving. There must be a carefully proving of that medicines, that is carefully distinguished from one another and tested by careful So for this reason, the medicines which are prepared or which are used for the purpose of life and death can be tested carefully by the pure experiments on the healthy body to ascertain their powers and their real effect in order to avoid any mistake in their employment. And for this reason, we have to ascertain their powers and effects, that what the real effects we seen after giving that medicines, that is to avoid any mistakes when we use that medicine in a disease condition. And for this reason, the drug proving is the most important and most pure experiment procedure. In this, we put for the notifications or the recording of the symptoms, which is done on a provers, and by these records we use that record for the cure of the patients or to avoid any mistakes in their employment in diseases, so that health of the body and the mind can be rapidly and permanently restored. So this is the importance of careful proving of drugs, that why we prove the, or what is the importance of careful proving of drugs. As we know that by careful proving of drugs, we get about the knowledge of medicines, and these medicines are the sub things on which the man's life and death is depend. And for this reason, we have to carefully distinguished from one another and tested by a careful pure experiments on healthy body. So this is regarding the aphorism number 120, as each and everything of a man, that is death, disease and health, depends on the medicine. So the medicine must be tested carefully in order to get the correct knowledge of their signs and symptoms. So what is the theme of aphorism number 120? That is careful drug proving. As each and everything of man, that is, it may be a disease condition, it may be a life or a health, or it may be a death. All these are depend on the medicine. And so the medicine must be tested carefully in order to get correct knowledge of their signs and symptom. So this is aphorism number 120. Then in aphorism number 121, what is given in aphorism number 121? First, I will read the aphorism. In aphorism number 121, in proving medicines to ascertain their effects on the healthy body, it must be borne in mind that the strong heroic substances, as they are termed, are liable even in small doses to produce changes in the health even of robust person. Those of milder power must be given for these experiments in more considerable quantities in order to observe the action of the every weakest. However, the subject of experiment should be person free from disease and who are delicate, irritable and sensitive. So what is the theme of aphorism number 121? It is regarding the use of a drug substances, the what type of substances we are using for a drug proving. In this, if we use the strong heroic substances that are liable even in small doses to produce changes in the health even of robust person, that is, when we use the strong heroic substances, when we use the milder substances or very weak substances. So when we use the strong heroic substances, in that case, it produces the changes in health. That is, the strong heroic substances in small doses to produce the changes in health even of robust person. That is, robust persons are the person on which there is no change happens very easily. So these are the robust person. But when we use the strong heroic substances for the proving purpose, this even in small doses also produces the changes in health of that even of robust person. And when we use the milder substance in more considerable quantities in order to observe the action even in the very weakest, that is, when we use the mild substances for the proving, we have to take the large quantity or a considerable quantity of that substance to see the action or to observe the action that is even in a very weakest person. As strong heroic substances produces changes in small doses in robust person also, but when we use the mild substances, we have to take the considerable quantities or the large quantity of that substance and to observe the action even in a very weakest person. So this is regarding the what substance we are using for the proving purpose. It must be a strong heroic substance or it must be a milder substances. So the subjects of experiment should be free from, that is, delicate, irritable and sensitive. So the subjects of experiments, that is the subject we are using for the experiment purpose, they should be free from delicateness, irritable and the sensitiveness. This is regarding the aphorism number 121, as the ascertainment of the doses of medicines for proving experiments. And in this, the strong substances are liable even in small doses to produce the changes in the health in the robust person. Those of milder power must be given in more considerable quantities, and in order to observe the action of the very weakest medicine, the subjects of experiment should be healthy person who are delicate, irritable and sensitive. So this is regarding the aphorism number 121. We know that this is the third part. First, we divided the drug proving in different parts. In this aphorism number 105 to 110, it is regarding the pathogenetic effect of drug. Then second point is that is aphorism number 111 to 120. It is regarding the primary and secondary action of the drug. Then third point is that is aphorism number 121 and 122. It is regarding the ascertainment of the doses of medicine for proving experiments. This is the third point, that is ascertainment of the doses of medicines for the proving experiments. And they explain in this, that is aphorism number 121 and 122. So I hope you understand the aphorism number 121. It is regarding the what should be the doses of substances for proving purposes. It may be a strong substances or it may be milder or the weakest substances. That is, if the strong substances are liable even in a small doses to produce the changes in health even in robust person. And second one, that is those of milder power must be given in more considerable quantities even in for a weakest person.
तो हेलो एग्जामिन
एवरीवन प्लीज म्यूट द ऑडियो। सो वी आर डिस्कसिंग द एफोरिज्म नंबर 121। इट इज रिगार्डिंग द असर्टेनमेंट ऑफ द डोसेस ऑफ मेडिसिन फॉर प्रूविंग एक्सपेरिमेंट्स। And in this we see the three points, that is first for the strong heroic substances, second for the milder substances, and the third point, that is in order to observe the action of weakest medicine, the subject of experiment should be healthy person who are delicate, irritable and sensitive. Then in aphorism number 122, in this first I will read the aphorism. That is aphorism number 122. In these experiments on which depends the exactitude of the whole medical art and the weal of all future generations of mankind, no other medicines should be employed except such as are perfectly well known and of whose purity, genuineness and energy we are thoroughly assured. So what is given in aphorism number 122? It is regarding the proving of a genuine drug. The drug which we prove, it must be a genuine drug. That is, it must be a free from all the impurities and all the admixtures. The drug which we prove on a healthy human being, it must be a genuine medicine. It must be a pure medicine. And it shows its effect in all the levels. That is, in order to get the signs and symptoms, as Dr. Hahnemann has enlisted in Materia Medica Pura, medicinal substance which is to be administered must be perfectly well known and must be perfectly pure. That is, which substance we are going to use for the drug proving, that substance we have to thoroughly know. We have to know its physical appearance, we have to know its physical properties, its chemical properties and all things regarding that medicines. And when we know the each and everything about that medicine, then we can use that medicine for the purpose of proving. And when we use that medicines for the proving, it must be well known and it must be a pure medicine. So this is given in aphorism number 122, that is the medicine which we use, it must be thoroughly known and it must be a genuine medicine or a genuine drug or it must be a pure. So this is a short aphorism that is regarding proving of a genuine drug, that is aphorism number 122. So this is the third point in the different parts of drug proving, that is the ascertainment of the doses of medicine for proving experiments. Now the fourth point in that is the methods of preparation of drug for proving experiments. What is the method of preparation of drugs for proving experiments? And in this is aphorism number 123. The first group, I will again repeat it, we divided the drug proving into different parts. In this first part is regarding aphorism number 105 to 110, and it is regarding the pathogenic effect of the medicine. Then second point is of, that is aphorism number 111 to 120. It is regarding the primary and secondary action of drug. Then third point, that is aphorism number 121 and 122. It is the ascertainment of doses of medicines for proving experiments. And now the fourth point is that the method of preparation of drugs for proving experiments. This is the fourth point, that is method of preparation of drugs for proving experiments. In this, I will first read the aphorism number 123, that is given in 6th edition. You have to listen carefully, then I will explain it. Aphorism number 123. Each of these medicines must be taken in a perfectly simple, unadulterated form. The indigenous plants in the form of freshly expressed juice mixed with little alcohol to prevent its spoiling. Exotic vegetable substances, however, in the form of powder or tincture prepared with alcohol when they were in the fresh state and afterwards melt with a certain proportion of water, salts and gums, however, should be dissolved in water just before being taken. If the plant can only be procured in its dry state and if its powers are naturally weak, and in that case there may be used for the experiment an infusion of it made by cutting the herb into small pieces and pouring boiling water on it so as to extract its medicinal parts immediately after its preparation. It must be swallowed whilst still warm, as all expressed vegetable juices and all aqueous infusions of herbs without the addition of spirit pass rapidly into fermentation and decomposition, where all their medicinal properties are lost. So this is aphorism number 123, and what is explained in this aphorism as the medicine must be perfectly simple and in an unadulterated form. That is how the preparation of medicines is done for the method of proving experiments. That is, what should be the method of preparation of drugs for proving experiments. And in this, each of the medicines must be taken in a perfectly simple and unadulterated form. That is, it is a simple substance that can be taken, and in an unadulterated form means do not change by any other medicines. The medicine is in a pure form. The medicine which we are going to taken for the purpose of proving, it must be in an unadulterated form or in a without any admixture of any substance. So this is first point, that is regarding the preparation of medicines. And then in this second point is that if the medicinal plant is indigenous, means the plant is available at the site of proving, that we called it as a indigenous plants. Means we are doing the proving at Adefata and we are having the medicinal plant available at Adefata. So this is the preparation of that indigenous plant if the plant is available at the native place. So what is done in this? In the form of freshly expressed juice that can be mixed with little alcohol to prevent its spoiling. So while preparing the indigenous plant, we have to express its juice, that is fresh juice is expressed, and that can be mixed with a little alcohol to prevent the spoiling of that plant. So this is method for the indigenous plant, that is the plant which are the available at native places. Then second one, that is exotic plants. Exotic plants or the vegetables are those vegetables that are not available at native place and that are exported from other place. So these are the exotic vegetable substances. And how to prepare the medicines or the drug from that exotic substances. So in the form of powder or tinctures prepared with alcohol when they are in fresh state and afterwards mingled with a certain proportion of water. So what to do regarding the exotic vegetable substances? We have to export that substance in a powder form or in a tinctures form. So we get that substances in a powder form, that we have to prove that medicine. If for example we have to prove that medicines at Arifata, and at Arifata this medicine is not available, and we have to export that medicines from, for example, from Delhi. If we have to export that medicine from the Delhi, then we take that medicine in a powder form, and in powder form it available at Arifata, we mix with alcohol. If it is, they were in a fresh state, if they, the powder is in a fresh state, we mixed it with alcohol, and afterwards, after some days, we mingled it with a certain proportion of water, that is we mix certain proportion of water to it. This is regarding the exotic vegetable substances. First one regarding the indigenous plants which are available at native places. So in that case we have to take the fresh juice of that plant, and that is mixed with alcohol to prevent the spoiling. And if the plant is of exotic nature, we have to collect it in a powder form or in a, and tinctures can be prepared by mixing the alcohol if they are in a fresh state, and after some days we have to mix some proportion of water to it. This is regarding exotic substances. Then third form is if the plants are the some salts or gums, in that case should be dissolved in water just before being taken. If our substances or the plants are in a, or the drug substance is in the form of any salt or in a gums, so when we use the salts and gums as a medicinal substance, that should be dissolved in water just before being taken. If we have to taken that medicine from today, so before that we have to mix them with water or dissolve in water, and then use for the purpose of proving. So this is regarding salts and gums. And fourth point is regarding dried drugs, that is if we use the dried drugs for the proving purposes, that is we have some stems or roots of plants in a dry form. In dry form we have to cut the herb into small pieces and pouring a boiling water on it. So what to do in that cases? If you have a dried drug substances, in that case you have to cut the dried drug substances into small pieces, and after this you have to pour boiling water on it so as to extract its medicinal parts. That is after pouring a boiling water, you have to extract its medicinal parts immediately after its preparation. It must be swallowed whilst still warm, as all expressed vegetable juices and all aqueous infusions of herbs without the addition of spirits pass rapidly into fermentation and decomposition, whereby all their medicinal properties are lost. And when we using the dry drug substances, in case of dry drug substances, you have to cut them into small pieces and pour a boiling water on it, and you have to extract that medicinal parts, and you have to immediately use that. That is immediately after its preparation it must be swallowed. That is this substance can be swallowed immediately after preparation, that is after pouring the boiling water, as after some time the expressed vegetable juices and all aqueous infusions of herbs, that is the vegetable juices and aqueous infusions of herbs means the liquid part of that herbs without the addition of spirit, that is if you do not add spirit to them, they pass rapidly into fermentation. As these are dried substances and you using a boiling water and you put for them for a long period, they may get into fermentation and decomposition, whereby their medicinal properties can get lost. For this reason, these dry substances can be you have to immediately used for the preparation of drugs and for the proving purposes. So this is the aphorism that is regarding the methods of preparation of drugs of proving experiments. So in this aphorism, this is the most important aphorism as it can be many time asked for 5 mark short notes. That is, what are the different methods of drug preparation for proving experiments? And in this, you have to remember these 4 points. That is, first point is regarding the medicine must be in a perfectly simple and unadulterated form. Second point regarding the indigenous plants, that is the plants which are available at native place. In that case, you have to extract the fresh juice and that can be mixed with alcohol and can be used for the purpose of proving. Then second, regarding the exotic vegetable substances that can be available in a powdered form, that can be mixed with alcohol, and after some days you have to pour little water or certain proportion of water to it. And if the substances is in the form of salts and gums, you have to dissolve them in water just before being taken. And in the form of dry drug substances, you have to cut that herbs into small pieces and pour boiling water, and immediately you have to use that preparation, as after some times it may get fermented or decomposed without addition of spirit, where they can lose their medicinal properties. So these are the different methods of preparation of drug for the purpose of drug proving. So this is aphorism number 123. I hope all of you understand aphorism number 120, 121, 122 and 123. What we studied in this lecture. So all of you understand?
Yes, ma'am.
Any difficulty, any question regarding aphorisms which we finished up till now? Yes, anyone? Yes, any difficulty? So I will ask the question to you. Roll number 41. Abhishek, be prepared with attendance. Roll number 41.
Ma'am, absent is what? Amar.
Amar hai ka? 42.
Maaza hai.
Vaasla ka kalcha lecture? Aikla ka? Sorry.
Ma'am, thoda aikla. Sagana.
What is idiosyncrasy?
They are the people when they are exposed to certain small doses of that substances, they get symptoms in exaggerated form.
Yes. What is the exact definition that is told by Dr. Hanuman, that is given in 117 aphorism? That 1 to 2 words you have to remember. That is, it is a peculiar corporeal constitution. And afterwards, the part you have told can be explained. Okay. Next aphorism, roll number 43. Who is 43? कौन है 43?
ऋषि है मैम, ऋषि है मैम, ना ये एब्सेंट है तो।
44 44 45 Abhishek, write down the attendance. Only 41s are present. Sincerely note down the attendance. Yes, Shraddha, 45.
Ma'am, I'm 46.
Okay, what is given in aphorism number 116?
116 मध्ये असं दिलंय की
हॅलो
हां यस
116 मध्ये असं दिलंय की जर आपण एखादा ड्रग प्रूव्ह करत असू तर आपण तो नंबर ऑफ पर्सन वरती प्रूव्ह केला पाहिजे. कारण जर काही ग्रुप म्हणजे काही सिम्पटम असे आहेत जे सगळ्या लोकांमध्ये दिसू शकतात सगळ्या प्रूव्हरमध्ये, पण काही सिम्पटम असे आहेत जे थोड्याच पर्सनमध्ये दिसू शकतात, त्यामुळे ड्रग प्रूव्ह करताना तो नंबर ऑफ पर्सन वरती प्रूव्ह केला पाहिजे.
ओके प्रणवती 44 आहे का? हाँ सर 45. व्हाट इज अल्टरनेटिंग एक्शन?
मैम एफोरिज्म नंबर 115 मध्ये
यस. व्हाट इज अल्टरनेटिंग एक्शन? सांगितले ना मी, काल पण रिपीट केलं होतं, आज पण रिपीट केलं. अक्षता एवढी लेट का जॉईन झाली? अक्षता ओके ठीक आहे, परत ऐक रेकॉर्डिंग. प्रणोती नेक्स्ट नंबर कोण आहे? 47 48 हो झालो. हु इज 671718? हु इज 671718? ऐकायला येतो ना आवाज माझा?